Harper Audio presents Before I Fall by Lauren Oliver, performed by Sarah Drew. Copyright 2010 by Lauren Oliver. Production copyright 2010 by HarperCollins Publishers. Prologue. They say that just before you die, your whole life flashes before your eyes. But that's not how it happened for me. To be honest, I'd always thought the whole final moment mental life scan thing sounded pretty awful. Some things are better left buried and forgotten, as my mom would say. I'd be happy to forget all of fifth grade, for example. The glasses and pink braces period. And does anybody want to relive the first day of middle school? Add in all of the boring family vacations, pointless algebra classes, period cramps, and bad kisses I barely lived through the first time around. The truth is, though, I wouldn't have minded reliving my greatest hits. When Rob Cochran and I first hooked up in the middle of the dance floor at homecoming so everyone saw and knew we were together. When Lindsay, Elodie, Allie, and I got drunk and tried to make snow angels in May, leaving person-sized imprints in Allie's lawn. My sweet 16 party, when we set out 100 tea lights and danced on the table in the backyard. The time Lindsay and I pranked Clara Seuss on Halloween, got chased by the cops, and laughed so hard we almost threw up. The things I wanted to remember, the things I wanted to be remembered for. But before I died, I didn't think of Rob. Or any other guy. I didn't think of all the outrageous things I'd done with my friends. I didn't even think of my family, or the way the morning light turns the walls in my bedroom the color of cream, or the way the azaleas outside my window smell in July, a mixture of honey and cinnamon. Instead, I thought of Vicky Hallinan. Specifically, I thought of the time in fourth grade when Lindsay announced in front of the whole gym class that she wouldn't have Vicky on her dodgeball team. "She's too fat," Lindsay blurted out. "You could hit her with your eyes closed." I wasn't friends with Lindsay yet, but even then she had this way of saying things that made them hilarious, and I laughed along with everyone else while Vicky's face turned as purple as the underside of a storm cloud. That's what I remembered in that before-death instant, when I was supposed to be having some big revelation about my past. The smell of varnish and the squeak of our sneakers on the polished floor, the tightness of my polyester shorts, the laughter echoing around the big, empty space like there were way more than 25 people in the gym. And Vicky's face. The weird thing is that I hadn't thought about that in forever. It was one of those memories I didn't even know I remembered, if you know what I mean. It's not like Vicky was traumatized or anything. That's just the kind of thing that kids do to each other. It's no big deal. There's always going to be a person laughing and somebody getting laughed at. It happens every day, in every school, in every town in America, probably in the world, for all I know. The whole point of growing up is learning to stay on the laughing side. Vicky wasn't very fat to begin with. She just had some baby weight on her face and stomach. And before high school, she'd lost that and grown 3 inches. She even became friends with Lindsay. They played field hockey together and said hi in the halls. One time, our freshman year, Vicky brought it up at a party. We were all pretty tipsy, and we laughed and laughed. Vicky, most of all, until her face turned almost as purple as it had all those years ago in the gym. That was weird thing number one. Even weirder than that was the fact that we'd all just been talking about it. How it would be just before you died, I mean. I don't remember exactly how it came up, except that Elodie was complaining that I always got shotgun and refusing to wear her seatbelt. She kept leaning forward into the front seat to scroll through Lindsay's iPod, even though I was supposed to have DJ privileges. I was trying to explain my greatest hits theory of death, and we were all picking out what those would be. Lindsay picked finding out that she got into Duke, obviously, and Allie, who was bitching about the cold, as usual, and threatening to drop dead right there of pneumonia, participated long enough to say she wished she could relive her first hookup with Matt Wilde forever, which surprised no one. Lindsay and Elodie were smoking, and freezing rain was coming in through the cracked open windows. The road was narrow and winding, and on either side of us, the dark, stripped branches of trees lashed back and forth like the wind had set them dancing. Elodie put on Splinter by Fallacy to piss Allie off, maybe because she was sick of her whining. It was Allie's song with Matt, who had dumped her in September. Allie called her a bitch and unbuckled her seatbelt, leaning forward and trying to grab the iPod. Lindsay complained that someone was elbowing her in the neck. The cigarette dropped from her mouth and landed between her thighs. She started cursing and trying to brush the embers off the seat cushion, and Elodie and Allie were still fighting, and I was trying to talk over them, reminding them all of the time we'd made snow angels in May. The tires skidded a little on the wet road, and the car was full of cigarette smoke, little wisps rising like phantoms in the air. Then, all of a sudden, there was a flash of white in front of the car. Lindsay yelled something, words I couldn't make out, something like sit, or shit, or sight. And suddenly, the car was flipping off the road and into the black mouth of the woods. I heard a horrible screeching sound, metal on metal, glass shattering, a car folding in two, and smelled fire. I had time to wonder whether Lindsay had put her cigarette out. Then, Vicky Hallinan's face came rising out of the past. I heard laughter echoing and rolling all around me, swelling into a scream. Then nothing. The thing is, you don't get to know. It's not like you wake up with a bad feeling in your stomach. You don't see shadows where there shouldn't be any. You don't remember to tell your parents that you love them or, in my case, remember to say goodbye to them at all. If you're like me, you wake up 7 minutes and 47 seconds before your best friend is supposed to be picking you up. You're too busy worrying about how many roses you're going to get on Cupid Day to do anything more than throw on your clothes, brush your teeth, and pray to God you left your makeup in the bottom of your messenger bag so you can do it in the car. If you're like me, your last day starts like this. Chapter 1. Beep. Beep, Lindsay calls out. A few weeks ago, my mom yelled at her for blasting her horn at 6:55 every morning, and this is Lindsay's solution. I'm coming, I shout back, even though she can see me pushing out the front door, trying to put on my coat and wrestle my binder into my bag at the same time. At the last second, my 8-year-old sister, Izzy, tugs at me. What? I whirl around. She has little sister radar for when I'm busy, late, or on the phone with my boyfriend. Those are always the times she chooses to bother me. You forgot your glove, she says, except it comes out. You forgot your glove. She refuses to go to speech therapy for her lisp, even though all the kids in her grade make fun of her. She says she likes the way she talks. I take them from her. They're cashmere, and she's probably gotten peanut butter on them. She's always scooping around in jars of the stuff. What did I tell you, Izzy? I say, poking her in the middle of the forehead. Don't touch my stuff. She giggles like an idiot, and I have to hustle her inside while I shut the door. If it were up to her, she would follow me around all day like a dog. By the time I make it out of the house, Lindsay's leaning out the window of the tank. That's what we call our car, an enormous silver Range Rover. Every time we drive around in it, at least one person says, that thing's not a car, it's a truck. And Lindsay claims she could go head-to-head with an 18-wheeler and come out without a scratch. She and Allie are the only two of us with cars that actually belong to them. Allie's car is a tiny black Jetta that we named the Mini-Me. I get to borrow my mom's Accord sometimes. Poor Elodie has to make do with her father's ancient tan Ford Taurus, which hardly runs anymore. The air is still and freezing cold. The sky is a perfect pale blue. The sun has just risen, weak and watery looking, like it has just spilled itself over the horizon and is too lazy to clean itself up. It's supposed to storm later, but you'd never know. I get into the passenger seat. Lindsay's already smoking, and she gestures with the end of her cigarette to the Dunkin' Donuts coffee she got for me. Bagels, I say.
In the back.
Sesame?
Obviously.
She looks me over once as she pulls out of my driveway.
Nice skirt.
You too. Lindsay tips her head, acknowledging the compliment. We're actually wearing the same skirt. There are only 2 days of the year when Lindsay, Allie, Elodie, and I deliberately dress the same.
Pajama day during Spirit Week because we all bought cute matching sets at Victoria's Secret last Christmas. And Cupid day. We spent 3 hours at the mall arguing about whether to go for pink or red outfits. Lindsay hates pink. Allie lives in it. And we finally settled on black mini skirts and some red fur-trimmed tank tops we found in the clearance bin at Nordstrom. Like I said, those are the only times we deliberately look alike. But the truth is that at my high school, Thomas Jefferson, everyone kind of looks the same. There's no official uniform, it's a public school, but you'll see the same outfit of 7 jeans, gray New Balance sneakers, a white t-shirt, and a colored North Face fleece jacket on 9 out of 10 students. Even the guys and the girls dress the same, except our jeans are tighter and we have to blow out our hair every day. It's Connecticut. Being like the people around you is the whole point. That's not to say that our high school doesn't have its freaks. It does. But even the freaks are freaky in the same way. The eco-geeks ride their bikes to school and wear clothing made of hemp and never wash their hair, like having dreadlocks will somehow help curb the emission of greenhouse gases. The drama queens carry big bottles of lemon tea and wear scarves even in summer and don't talk in class because they're conserving their voices. The Math League members always have 10 times more books than anyone else and actually still use their lockers and walk around with permanently nervous expressions, like they're just waiting for somebody to yell, boo. I don't mind it, actually. Sometimes Lindsay and I make plans to run away after graduation and crash in a loft in New York City with this tattoo artist her stepbrother knows. But secretly, I like living in Ridgeview. It's reassuring, if you know what I mean. I lean forward, trying to apply mascara without gouging my eye out. Lindsay's never been the most careful driver and has a tendency to jerk the wheel around, come to sudden stops, and then gun the engine. Patrick better send me a rose, Lindsay says as she shoots through one stop sign and nearly breaks my neck slamming on the brakes at the next one. Patrick is Lindsay's on-again, off-again boyfriend. They've broken up a record 13 times since the start of the school year. I had to sit next to Rob while he filled out the request form, I say, rolling my eyes. It was like forced labor. Rob Cochran and I have been going out since October. But I've been in love with him since 6th grade, when he was too cool to talk to me. Rob was my first crush, or at least my first real crush. I did once kiss Kent McFuller in 3rd grade, but that obviously doesn't count since we just exchanged dandelion rings and were pretending to be husband and wife. Last year, I got 22 roses. Lindsay flicks her cigarette butt out of the window and leans over for a slurp of coffee. I'm going for 25 this year. Each year before Cupid Day, the student council sets up a booth outside the gym. For $2 each, you can buy your friends valigrams, roses with little notes attached to them, and then they get delivered by Cupids, usually freshmen or sophomore girls trying to get in good with the upperclassmen, throughout the day. I'd be happy with 15, I say. It's a big deal how many roses you get. You can tell who's popular and who isn't by the number of roses they're holding. It's bad if you get under 10 and humiliating if you don't get more than 5. It basically means that you're either ugly or unknown. Probably both. Sometimes people scavenge for dropped roses to add to their bouquets, but you can always tell. So, Lindsay shoots me a sideways glance. Are you excited? The big day, opening night, she laughs, no pun intended. I shrug and turn toward the window, watching my breath frost the pane. It's no big deal. Rob's parents are away this weekend, and a couple of weeks ago he asked me if I could spend the whole night at his house. I knew he was really asking if I wanted to have sex. We've gotten semi-close a few times, but it's always been in the back of his dad's BMW or in somebody's basement or in my den with my parents asleep upstairs, and it's always felt wrong. So when he asked me to stay the night, I said yes, without thinking about it. Lindsay squeals and hits her palm against the steering wheel. No big deal? Are you kidding? My baby's growing up. Oh, please. I feel heat creeping up my neck and know my skin's probably going red and splotchy. It does this whenever I'm embarrassed. All the dermatologists, creams, and powders in Connecticut don't help. When I was younger, kids used to sing, "What's red and white and weird all over? Sam Kingston." I shake my head a little.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.